We begin with the top Democrat in the Senate, Majority Leader Harry Reid, announcing that the full Senate will start debating its health reform bill next week. So clear your calendar. According to Senator Reid, the Senate will pass a bill by Christmas. Some of the Senate Democrats who will be voting on that bill got a morale boost visit today from former President Bill Clinton. Mr. Clinton returned to the Hill 15 years after his failed effort to reform the health care system. His mission this time was to rally Senate Democrats during their weekly closed-door luncheon. The prospects of getting health reform passed this year also got a boost in recent days from the renewed support of the American Medical Association. The AMA fully endorsed the House version of the bill that passed over the weekend, and it was among the organizations that put itself on record in favor of reform during a Rose Garden event with President Obama last month. Now, having the AMA on the side of comprehensive health reform has been a huge boon for those who are in favor of it. This is the American Medical Association. Which is why it's causing a bit of a stir that there's an internal debate at an AMA policy meeting in Houston this week over whether or not they will rescind that all-important endorsement. The rescind the endorsement effort is being led by a Louisiana doctor named Donald Palmisano, who is a former president of the AMA. In addition to being a former AMA president, Dr. Palmisano is also the national spokesman for a group called the Coalition to Protect Patients' Rights. Coalition to Protect Patients' Rights. Why does that name sound so familiar? Oh, okay. Coalition for Patients' Rights, Conservatives for Patients' Rights. Two different things, both against health reform. Conservatives for Patients' Rights is another anti-health reform group that's run by Rick Scott, former head of a hospital chain, resigned in disgrace after his company got caught defrauding the government. The company had to pay a $1.7 billion fine, billion with a B. That's Conservatives for Patients' Rights. This is the other group. This is Coalition to Protect Patients' Rights, an ostensibly grassroots organization that's been lobbying aggressively against health reform for months now. On their website, they call themselves, quote, a nonpartisan grassroots coalition made up of over 10,000 doctors, healthcare providers, advocacy groups, and concerned citizens. Just a grassroots coalition, just sprung up organically. Well, back in July, this grassroots coalition to protect patients' rights held a news conference at the National Press Club in Washington. At the time, the Press Club's official website listed an organization called the DCI Group as the official sponsor of that event. Well, the DCI Group confirmed to the website Think Progress that they were, in fact, coordinating the PR for the Coalition to Protect Patients' Rights. What's the DCI Group doing the PR for this ostensibly grassroots organization? Well, the DCI Group is a Washington, D.C.-based lobbying and PR firm that represents some very, very, very big-time corporate clients. This year, for example, DCI has been busy lobbying Congress on behalf of the giant oil company ExxonMobil. DCI has also been doing lots of lobbying work for the U.S. Telecom Association and specifically for the big wireless provider Verizon. Before forming this lobbying venture, you should know that DCI's chairman, CEO, and one of their founding partners all came from the tobacco industry. All had worked for the tobacco giant R.J. Reynolds. In the 90s, when R.J. Reynolds was trying to defeat restrictions on smoking and new regulations and taxes on the tobacco industry, the soon-to-be DCI executives got to work creating grassroots-ish smokers' rights groups. You remember this? R.J. Reynolds hired the company of DCI's current CEO to develop a, quote, network of smokers' rights groups and other coalition partners within the region that will speak out on issues important to the company. The idea was to draft letters to the editor and bombard local talk radio to make it look like there was all this grassroots support for the tobacco industry. DCI's executives took that craft that they perfected at R.J. Reynolds with the fake grassroots smokers' rights campaigns, and they've been applying it to the needs of all sorts of corporate clients ever since. When the Bush White House, for example, wanted to drum up fake grassroots support for privatizing Social Security back in 2005, they called a group run by DCI. When corporate clients like Exxon or Microsoft hire DCI to lobby for them, they get DCI's fake news website, which specializes in editorializing for those corporate interests, but making it look like legitimate independent news and commentary. For example, chemical ban will not help kids. Or there's this one, socializing medicine in three easy steps. It's corporate PR spin made to look like news, or made to look like grassroots opposition to smoking bans, or made to look like grassroots opposition to health reform. Except when you spend 15 minutes Googling them and it all just falls apart like something made out of spun sugar in a rainstorm. Joining us now is MSNBC contributor and Newsweek investigative correspondent Michael Isikoff. Mr. Isikoff, good to see you again. Thanks for joining us.
Good to see you, Rachel.
I know you've done some reporting on the DCI group in the past. What can you tell us about other political issues that they've been involved in Washington that we might know about?
Well, they're sort of state-of-the-art, multi-dimensional Washington lobbying political firm. One thing that I think you touched on, but they've always had a distinctly political bent. They were very much involved in a group called Progress for America during the 2004 campaign. That was one of these so-called 527s, independent advocacy groups that essentially was running ads for the Bush campaign, promoting Bush's re-election, but because it was a 527, and both sides did this, but Progress for America was the big player on the Republican side, there was no disclosure of who was financing the organization, who was contributing. Now, what's interesting about those lobbying records, and there's a continuing theme here, you showed they now represent ExxonMobil, Verizon, but you won't see any reference to them representing any healthcare companies or healthcare interests. Because they're doing this, this coalition to protect patient rights, as under the rubric of grassroots astroturf lobbying, they don't have to disclose who's paying for that. So we can presume that some healthcare companies' interests are financing this, but there's no disclosure. That's, I think, the theme that you get when you look at how DCI Group operates.
And how a lot of these groups operate. I feel like all of the astroturfing reporting that we have done runs up against that over and over and over again. As long as they say it's grassrootsy and nonprofit, no matter who's running it, they don't have to disclose anything.
Absolutely. And I do want to point out, Rachel, both sides do this. Mm-hmm. Last year, I wrote about a company called Ask Strategies, a Chicago public relations firm that happened to be one of his senior partners was one David Axelrod, who said he was never a lobbyist. They were organized the company, a grassroots organization called Consumers for Reliable Electricity in Illinois, funded by Commonwealth Edison. But they were able to say, we're not lobbying, we're just running this grassroots organization. So this is very much a bipartisan phenomenon.
On that, though, I remember that around the time of the Republican National Committee, one of the things that you reported on was that the head of DCI was going to be running the Republican convention for the Republican Party, and they were able to be tied to some specific lobbying that made him such a political hot potato that he got fired after he got hired, right?
Right, exactly. I mean, this is one area where they were forced to disclose, and much to their chagrin. John McCain had selected the CEO of DCI Group, Doug Goodyear, to manage the Republican convention last year. I wrote a story shortly after that Doug Goodyear's firm, DCI Group, had previously represented the Burmese military junta. They'd been hired after George Bush was elected to help burnish the Burmese junta's image, and they ran a public relations campaign talking about how they were cracking down on the drug trade and how some of the allegations against them were false. Now, of course, the Burmese junta was long known as one of the most authoritarian, anti-democratic regimes in the world, with one of the worst human rights records. It happened to be my story, rather unfortunate for Douglas Goodyear, because this was right after the 2008 cyclone in Burma, where the Burmese junta was keeping out NGOs and outside relief workers. So I think the timing forced Douglas Goodyear to resign shortly after the story came out.
Michael Isikoff, MSNBC contributor and Newsweek investigative correspondent, thank you very much for your time tonight, Mike.
Thank you, Rachel.
I should note that we invited the president of the DCI Group to come on the show tonight. Unfortunately, he told us he was unavailable this evening. I am also available tomorrow at the same time. And I'm also available like every weeknight at this time. So maybe we will yet get a chance to talk.